So, end of the year, predictions for 2019. I think that it will not be perceived as the year of the start of the bull market, but will be perceived as another bad year for crypto. In 2014, we had a bear market. 2015, we actually saw the bottom in January. It went from maybe it was $300, it went down to $160 in the first month of 2015, and then it was around $200 for the whole year, except for the last month of December when it finally broke 250, 300, it went to 400, and it, the year ended around that price. And so, if you look at the start of the year, was 300, end of the year, 400. So, wow. Again, a year of profits, and in crypto that means like, oh, we're plus compared to 1st of January, we're at the end of the year plus 50% profit or plus 30% profit. Wow, we're again the best performer of all assets in the world. So that was 2015, and that started the bull market. That actually started that in 2016. But this year, 2019, I think we still have half a year to go to find the bottom. So I don't think we will see the bottom in January. And so that will color the perception. But most of all, I think that we will not end the year at the same price, at the higher price than we're entering this year. Is it $4,000 now or $3,600, $3,800 for Bitcoin? We will probably go to a low of 2,000 and possibly even $1,000. We'll have to see. And after that, gonna go back up for the second half year of 2019, but we will probably not be at $3,800 at the end of the year. Maybe we will be at $3,000, a lower price at the end of this year, huh? And so another negative year after a terrible 2018, another negative year of 2019. I think actually that is possible. For the stock market, had a bad year now, 2018, I actually can't really say much on the stock market because I really don't study that. But I think that the stock market, for the most part, actually is following crypto. I know that's a crazy statement, but actually it's not, because it's just there in the numbers. The highest risk assets will always move the strongest and move first. So at the end of the bull market that ended basically at the beginning of 2018, the stock market was similar with crypto. It went up the whole year of 2017 and peaked out in January. Or February, actually, for the stock market. Am I recording? No, I'm not. Yes, I am. The crypto markets started to collapse before the stock market. It was only a difference of a couple of weeks, but that counts. But for example, other high-risk assets like supercars started to already correct in 2016, 2017. So they went up starting 2009, but already found a peak a year before the stock market found a peak. So and I think it's the same with crypto. So if this pattern stays the same, then actually crypto will bottom before the stock market will bottom, which means that the stock market will also correct for another half year, maybe a few months later, and find the bottom there and then go up. But probably will also end the year of 2019 at a similar or slightly lower valuation than it's entering this year. So that's interesting, I think. And yeah, just from a valuation perspective, there is still a lot of work to do in the market. If you look at market caps of coins, I haven't watched today or recently, but many coins are still worth a billion. Hmm? And I don't think that's justified. Coins like IOTA or in the top 10, I don't even know the names, but they are worth a billion. And they have no users. They are just in development, early development stage. So there is just no. Sometimes there is not even a workable product, a usable product. So that's still overvalued. Of course, recommendations for to do in 2019. I think 2019 will be a very important year to stash up and build your crypto position, and if you're investing in stocks, build your stock position, because I think the most probable scenario by far, maybe no, Jesus, is, I have to keep the little girls away from your computer, eh? Very important, eh? So, because we are in a long-term bull cycle for stocks, and watch my videos I made 1-2 months ago on the long-term history returns. I made a video where you see the returns from 100 years. And we're clearly in a long-term bull cycle that started in 2009, but will last 20 and probably 30 years. Just like after the Great Depression in the 30s was a bad decade, but the 40s, 50s and 60s, 30 years of bull market. And so the same will happen probably now. And so this correction in the stock market is only temporary. We might actually have seen the bottom already here. Like, it's possible that the stock market goes up first, but it will be a slow year. Similar than 1987, you also had a strong correction during a long-term bull cycle, the 80s and 90s. And so the year after 1988 was the slow year of recovery. And I expect the same for the stock market. Could start already this year, or could start only in middle 2019 when it finds a bottom. But it will be a slow year for stocks, but a very important year to buy stocks if you invest in stocks, especially if we would make newer lows, because it's a long-term bull cycle. It will go up a lot more. It's only US stocks that went up the past 10 years. European stocks, no. And emerging stocks went down or sideways the past 10 years, even though these markets have grown a lot the past 10 years since 2009. So this is just the start of a bull market where the strongest assets have gone up, which is US stocks, the biggest cash cows in the world, tech stocks like Google and Facebook or stocks that have obviously great future like Tesla. All these things have gone up very well the past 10 years, but the rest of the world not. So that's coming for the next 10 years and even the next 20 years. Do not invest in gold, in commodities, in cash, in bonds at such a low interest rate long term. These are all terrible ideas. Because the gold cycle, as I have mentioned so many times, it will take only 10 years and then it's like 20 years bear market minimum and possibly 30. And so we're only 10 years in. At least another 10 years of bear market for gold and commodities, possibly another 20 years. This is inversely correlated to stocks. But uranium did well. It was the best performing asset or commodity, just asset in 2018. I made videos on uranium a year ago telling that short term, yes, it's a good investment because it just went down from, what was the high, $100 or $120, went down to $20. Now it went up from $20 to $30 in 2018, so it was the only thing that went up, and went up a lot, 50% plus, so great investment if you would have bought it, but I decided not to buy it because I was convinced, and still am, that we're in a long-term bear market for commodities, but I also said that short-term it could be a good investment, but I don't do short-term investments, I only want, because it's too risky, because it could as well have continued to go down from $20 to $15 or even to $10, which I do think will be the low, but only to be reached in 5 to 10 years. So now it went up from 20 to 30. Is it time to now invest in uranium? No, it's a time to lock in these profits if you invest in uranium. But I have to admit that I was really considering investing in uranium, but I was going into the direction of investing in uranium stocks, and that was the wrong choice a year ago because stocks have suffered from the general stock market collapse, and so uranium stocks did not do well this year. So, but if you want to invest in something and you want to invest in stocks and not in crypto, well, actually uranium stocks make sense because uranium has done a rebound, so earnings for uranium miners are up a lot thanks to uranium valuations going up with 50%. So I mean, uranium stocks can short term be a good play, but long term, when you say invest in stock market, that is not invest in commodity stocks. No, commodity stocks will have a hard time when commodities go down in value, in purchasing power. Commodity miners have a hard time and need and make less and less profits, need to scale up to keep the profits at the same level. Many go broke, so you see consolidation. At the end of a commodity bear cycle, many commodity miners have gone broke or have been bought up by the biggest players, who are the only ones that are able to keep their companies alive. So commodity stocks is a bad idea in the long term, and so uranium miners are commodity miners, and a bad idea in the long term. But in the short term, they can, like this uranium short term cycle can last considerably longer than 1 year, can be 2 years, 3 years, that uranium goes up, peaking out at what I predicted would be like half of what it lost. So it went from $100 to $120 to $20, so it can go up from $20 to $60 or $50 before going down again to a new low. And so the next 2 years uranium may continue to go up, and uranium miners may start to pick up strong. So that's a short term, could be an interesting play, but in general commodities I think are a very bad idea. Gold also, silver also. And then there's what cryptos to buy. So I think we're gonna, like, 2019 is the year to prepare, to build your crypto stash, count how many coins you have of a certain crypto, not count how much the fiat value is of your portfolio. That's not important and depressing, but what's not depressing is count how many coins you're buying and building your stash of crypto. And then the question is which you should buy. And I still think the highest odds are for most coins to find their bottom together with Bitcoin. And when Bitcoin bottoms, you can also buy the top coins, top 5 coins, top 10 maximum. But I would say maybe top 5 that will bottom likely at the same time. And after that, have a chance to go up as the first ones. Usually it's just Bitcoin that goes up as the first one. But and so what you see is that even though most have bottomed in fiat value, you see that Bitcoin then starts to go up first. And then we're talking about end 2019 and also 2020, that only Bitcoin and the bigger coins go up in fiat value, but the smaller coins are still like continuing to be very close to their bottom prices that they reached in the middle of 2019, and don't see a bull recovery yet, and so no returns, and actually versus Bitcoin or versus Ethereum are continuing to go down for another year. That's what I think is the most probable, as happened in past bull markets. The quality goes up first, right? Like with the stock market, American companies, high-tech companies, is the highest quality, the biggest profit creators, the biggest value creators in the world go up the first, and the same is true in crypto. So a good way to play that is to only buy the top five at the bottom of 2019. And then you keep those, and as they go up versus the smaller coins, you wait a year, and then they probably have doubled or tripled versus the smaller coins, and then you can diversify it at the end of 2020 into smaller coins, like in my case I like Bitepole. I'm also invested in Bismuth. So I would make an exception to that, and that's BlackBytes, because some markets are extremely illiquid. BlackBytes has an exchange, Freebie, but it can take many months and sometimes half a year or year before your order is filled, even though you're not far from the market price. There is very few trading going on. So to build a position, you also need to take that into account. You want to invest in a small coin and you want to build a big position. Yeah, It can take years to build that. Eh? So if there's certain small coins that you really like, yes, and you do want to take a big position, let's say more than 1% of the supply or 5%, like that's a huge piece of the supply you want to buy. So you really need to start buying now. It can take 2 years before you achieve that position. But if it's a liquid coin, if the market cap is higher and there's no question, you will never be able to buy 1%, but it's only 0.1% or less, then you can just wait a year, 2 years before you start buying that, because and first invest in bigger coins and then with the bigger coins buy the smaller coins. What else? I bought an exchange, Freebie. The BlackByte exchange, the only exchange where you can trade BlackBytes for bytes. It's a decentralized exchange. You need to download the Bitepole wallet, and then buy some bytes on centralized exchange like Bittrex, and there's some others. You buy bytes there, and then you transfer to your Bitepole wallet, and then in your Bitepole wallet you have the store where you have different apps, and one of them is Freebie, the BlackByte exchange, and you go into that, and then you can place orders, buy and sell orders of your of bytes to buy or sell BlackBytes, and it's very beautifully made. It's a decentralized exchange, so there is a counterparty risk, but only for one part. I think it's when you put up orders to buy or sell, to buy BlackBytes, you basically put up orders with your bytes, but it's via smart contracts, and so the owner of the exchange cannot steal your bytes, because it's locked into smart contracts, and they get and so if somebody else sells you BlackBytes, then the smart contract is executed, and you will get your BlackBytes and you will lose your bytes. But it looks like, I'll put the link below of the website. It's like a traditional website exchange, in that you have buy orders, sell orders, and you can fill them up, and I think it's very beautifully made, and I was sad to hear that the founder, PX Runes, decided to stop with this project, because he wants to focus on other stuff. So it was very important to keep it alive, because it's the only BlackBytes exchange. BlackBytes, I think, is a great privacy coin, but it is not used yet anywhere, to my knowledge. So it's a very early stage project. And that's because it's not being marketed, the Black Bytes. It's a privacy coin of Byteball. But Byteball, when there is marketing, it's about the bytes, but not about the Black Bytes. So I think Black Bytes, the valuation is ridiculous. It's about 1 million for all Black Bytes in circulation. So it's a very cheap coin, a great investment, in my opinion. And over time, I think it will gain popularity as Byteball grows in popularity. People will discover Black Bytes too, and I think the value of Black Bytes versus Bytes will go up over time. Right now, it's like 0.02 byte per Black Byte, and that's because there is double the amount of Black Bytes in circulation. That's you could double that up, then the price is like 0.04, let's call it 5. So that's still like 20 times cheaper. Black Bytes are 20 times cheaper in market cap than Bytes. But If Byteball picks up and Bytes become valuable for other reasons, the characteristics of Byteball itself, of Bytes, is that it's a very user-friendly cryptocurrency that has a business model, and they have a big stash that they use to pay for marketing and development, and they also do a lot of free giveaways, but in exchange for a real adoption. So right now they have a lottery running, so everybody that owns Bytes automatically participates in the weekly lottery, and so that's one way now to motivate people to hold Bytes. But there are many other projects, like cashback program, for example. If merchants start to accept Bytes and you pay with Bytes with a merchant, you will get a 20% refund. And even if you pay with other crypto, you get 10% refund in the form of Bytes. So all kind of interesting adoption programs that I think is necessary for a crypto to find adoption. Byteball does that, and they have very easy to use smart contracts that are readable for a non-coder like us. And it's built on a very different architecture. It's DAG. I do think that that's the future, together with proof of stake. These cryptocurrencies need to be much more scalable and much more better secured. I do think proof of work security goes down over time as inflation goes down, and so in the long run new coins will use different architectures that are just better solutions to secure a coin, but also much more scalable, very important. And I think especially that aspect, DAG is doing very well by allowing different chains to exist parallel to each other and only need to touch each other at a later time. All kind of very interesting stuff why I like Byteball. So over time, I think that Byteball will do very well and will gain adoption. But this is a multi-year project, and now it's experiencing a real bear market where even talent is leaving, sadly. But that's just part of a real bear market. But I think over time, Byteball will grow. Bytes will gain in popularity, and Black Bytes too, because privacy coins. The last has not been said there. A coin like Monero, for example, is leading that segment. But there's a lot of, I think, overselling there, and a lot of course fudding of other coins. Monero has done a great job there, but from the research I've done, Monero actually had the way they create privacy is by mixing the information, the coins on chain. But that means that you can do analysis of it, and if you do good analysis of it, you might actually discover and follow the different paths the coins did, and do reveal information that should not be revealed, because people think they are doing private transactions. And for example, the first 2 years or 3 years, the way Monero was built, now it's discovered that 90% of all transactions can be easily traced back. I don't know if that's true, I haven't done deeper research in that, but I will link also this information below. So in order to create privacy for a coin, there are only a few solutions that are being worked on. First one is mixing coins on chain, as Monero does. The second one is encrypting the information on chain, as Zcash does. But in both cases, the information is available on chain forever. And so as decryption techniques or analyzing techniques become better over time, then that means that old history might be revealed in the future because it is available on chain. Blackbytes, Tony was very a true genius, the way he thought of creating privacy here. What he did was, instead of putting the information on chain, he put it in the coins themselves. Because of course there needs to be, the information needs to, you need certain kind of information to avoid that people can issue more coins, like with cash. Yes, it's a great privacy coin, bills, fiat bills, but because there is no blockchain, anybody can create cash, and many, the government does that very well, every day printing more cash put in their pocket. But actually, you and I can also print cash with some advanced, advanced machines, which is then called counterfeiting if you do it. But I actually use exactly the same machines as the government uses just to create more bills. And of course, that's what needs to be avoided, that anybody can create more coins, because then you have inflation and devaluation of the currency. But the way Tony has solved that with Blackbytes is you put the information in the coins themselves, and so who can read the information is only the recipient of the coins. He can read the information and verify if it's a real coin, if it's not an inflated coin or a counterfeited coin. But he's the only one that can read it. There is a chain used, the DAG chain of Byteball. And so for every transaction you do use bytes to pay for the transaction, but you send black bytes to other people, certain kind of information. The only information available is that you did a transaction, but because you pay a transaction fee in bytes, but you cannot see where the black bytes were sent to and how much black bytes were sent. This information is all basically hidden in a package that's sent from one user to the other. So I think it's a genius solution and might find real adoption in the future. I think Blackbytes, great investment, market cap right now of $1 million or maybe two, but that's it, very low. And so a great investment, and so you can buy them on Freeb via the Byteball wallet, an exchange I was very fortunate to buy, will be running with some other people. I'm very happy with that. I think these kind of moves are the right moves in a bear market. Exchanges are great investments, especially if you buy a leading exchange in a certain coin. In the case of Blackbytes, there were two exchanges, but one closed down already a couple months ago, Beep, and now the last exchange, Freeb, also was almost closing down. It's true, the volume is low, the earnings are low. I understand that the founder wanted to move on to something else, but this can all pick up a lot during a bull market. And especially in a coin like Blackbytes, this is a very small project still, but can expand a lot. So if you have the leading exchange and you succeed in keeping the leading volume, then that's a true network effect. It's very hard to beat that, to beat a leading exchange. Because the more users you have on an exchange, the more valuable the exchange becomes. The same with cryptocurrencies. And so the more users you have, the smaller the spread is between buy and sell. And the smaller you can make the fees also and still make more than your competitor. And the thicker the order books are, the available supply to buy and sell. And so this is very hard to beat. What you see is that leading exchanges usually lose their position because they just start to sit back, relax, don't do anything anymore, and let the market be taken by someone else, or they do some big fuck ups like losing the stash of their users in a theft. There's of course a lot involved in running an exchange, but yeah, a decentralized exchange excludes a lot of these risks by the users actually holding on to their coins. Even when they are trading, they are still the only owners and that can control the coins. So I think it's all great. So yeah, I hope you guys enjoyed the video. I'm thinking what else I can say. It's the last day of the year today. I hope that 2019 will be a beautiful year for you all, and that even if you face hardship, that you can see the beautiful things in life. The people that are the most happy are people that are grateful for what they have, even if they don't have much. If they are grateful, it's just an attitude in your head, but then you're happy. Of course, it's a little mind trick, because if you want to improve your life, you also need to be unhappy about certain things and really want to change certain things, otherwise you're not gonna get it. Bye.